We've got some bouncing to do here today, and it is going to show us a number of things. Particularly, we're going to be able to introduce something we haven't even talked about yet, and that's the force or force field, pressure or whatever, that it would be felt by one of these balls being hit by many, many hits by a small object. So we're going to develop a little bit of one-dimensional statistical mechanics here, statistical thermodynamics as well. We talk about a force field that would be called isothermal in a subject like that, or another one which we'll get another way that's called adiabatic, and these two opposites are important in classical physics, but also the idea of doing something suddenly or doing something gradually. Usually you think of gradual as this and sudden as that. We'll talk about that a little bit. And the idea of the force field and a potential field. We haven't mentioned the potential. Everything has been kinetic energy. Potential energy hasn't come up yet. I want to try to introduce that without any other axioms. I'm trying to be Occam razor here and say as little as possible and get as much information as we can efficiently. And while we're at it, we're going to talk about the difference between a physicist and a mathematician. Probably haven't maybe thought about that too much, but it's worth knowing because, in a sense, we're both, a little of both. And we're going to be very quantitative about the isothermal and adiabatic potentials as well as our fields. Then we're going to go crazy. We're going to have an infinitely large ball working on a small ball, very large M1, very tiny M2. It looks like it's going to be crushed, but it manages to keep something, and this is another quantity that we need to introduce for mechanics called action. And that's the quantity that gets quantized, so to speak, when you try to turn our classical mechanics to its fundamental quantum mechanics. So let's get started. The first thing, recall that we had a pretty large mass ratio just with 49. This is M1, the ball, and M2, the pen, being in ratio of 49 to 1. And I'll skip the animation because we've already seen it, but you have here the time plot, coordinates versus time, in which, and I'll just do the animation with my finger. The first one is bounce off the floor and then bounce off this one, throw this one up, get hit again here, throw it up, get hit again here, throw it up, get hit, get hit, get hit, get hit, and get turned around, and finally go running off. We've already done a problem sort of like that, but not with quite that mass ratio. Well, we're going to do some with even more ratio than that. And I will come back to this animation in a minute here to show the extreme case, which we're going to have, in which M2 is negligible mass compared to M1. And that's the what we need in order to make a continuous force field that will serve to also have a continuous potential field with it. And pretty much two kinds of things, adiabatic and isothermal, that we need to discuss. But in any case, this is the stage upon which we'll play at first. We'll start out with a very massive M1 and a very tiny M2. Now, how tiny? If you're doing thermodynamics with gases, you're talking about a piston that weighs, say, a kilogram or something here, and then you're talking about an oxygen or nitrogen or air atom or molecule of just, well, shall we say, astronomically small a mass. So that's really the kind of ratio that we would be talking about if we were going to carry this out as an exercise in gas thermodynamics. But for now, we've simplified it so that the atoms have the constraint to only be in one-dimensional motion, so we only have a y coordinate that happens to be tipped over in the horizontal direction here. We're talking about a y coordinate just like the one we've had all along. It's just now it's horizontal to the left. And our v2 is the speed that this would be bouncing back and forth, many, many bounces. But right now, with a very big distance here, we'll start off with a small velocity back and forth here, back and forth and back and forth, hardly moving this ball at all, many, many bounces before this thing starts to be pushed away if it started with no velocity at all. Whereas if I take this ball and move it in slowly, that's called isothermal. I move it in suddenly, that's called adiabatic. I will probably increase the velocity, but I certainly will increase the momentum transfer even if I don't increase the velocity. Because now the ball can go back and forth and give me a momentum transfer more often. Okay, so at this point we're talking about a lower V2 slope is, not changing much because this hasn't moved yet, but these are the momentum transfer, two pairs of momentum transfer actions going on to give it an extra delta P. Velocities here are essentially the same for those two, but we're going to talk about when that changes as well. But then if I move in, it's very likely not only will I have more hits per second, but I'll also have harder hits per second, bigger delta P's than I have here, you see. So this is why I call, in general, this momentum transfer is a double whammy. You're getting more hits and harder hits, higher velocities, both. But we'd like to separate that a little bit. We're going to talk about the isothermal case where you don't get a higher velocity, you just get more hits. That's called single plan. Okay? All right, we're going to play this game quantitatively and with it an introduction of force. Okay? So, I'm saying, being careful with my logic here, I'm saying this is more of a definition than another axiom. We're just defining a name for the ratio of delta P to delta T. So how much momentum's our axiomatic stuff, we're asking how much per second do I get? And the idea is that each delta P is a momentum of the in velocity minus the momentum associated with the final velocity of that little ball. Okay, so that's the transfer that's occurred given the axiom of momentum conservation. And this ball has received it, maybe positive or negative, but that's what it's getting, is a delta P of that amount. And then multiply that by bangs per second, you see. Okay, so this is momentum per second, which is force that we're recording. That's what you literally are feeling if you, and you've got to imagine this movie is going really fast, so we're feeling that, and it's so fast we don't feel the individual hits, as you know, when you pull on a balloon, you don't feel individual hits of the atoms, other than giving you the pressure. So that's what we're talking about. But in any case, the delta T that goes in the denominator here is this 1 over delta t is a velocity divided by distance here, okay, the distance is 2y. Okay, so whatever the coordinate y is, it's got to go out and back, so that's 2. And the velocity is it has at that moment, instantaneous v2, is in the numerator. Okay, so basically what we're going to be seeing, and this is something that we'll extrapolate to later on, but I wanted you to see right away on the velocity diagram what we're talking about here. So it would help for me at this point, and I'm going to use this computer to jump ahead here. and go ahead and just show you, if I can get away with this right here, I'm going to...
Isn't an approximation, Dr. Harder, 1 over delta t is equal to v2 over 2y? Because your picture looks like a slanting, right?
Yeah, we're talking here, in almost all of this stuff, the situation where m1 is greater than m2. Okay? So we're talking about a really skinny ellipse, right? Not too different from the ellipse that's sitting there with 49 to 1, except we're going to be told 49 times 10 to the 8th. It's essentially two parallel lines, right? But just to remind you what that looks like, okay, and this marvelous thing here where every time you increase by twice the velocity of the big guy, V1, M1. So little M2 is going to pick up that much each time. And you can kind of see it. At least I did when I did this animation quickly. Let's see if it will do it here. Okay, starting there, all right. Now, just pause for a minute. You see, this was our first throw, okay? So it threw us 4 total there. But afterwards, from now on, if it were really huge mass, okay, you would see this. Up two more, not quite because it's only 49, right? For 49, the game is over fairly quickly as far as this goes, okay? So once again, that big jump, almost to 4, back down to there, picked up two, but not quite 2, you see, and it peters up. So that's just a 49 to 1 ratio. What we're talking about here on our diagram, really huge, okay, or really skinny. So we're going to go pick up 2. Won't be till we get up here we start not picking up as much as 2. But in our calculation, we're just going to take that as our rule. Okay, so we're going to be adding that much velocity to this. Okay, I'm going to stop this guy right now. And go on. Let's see what the algebra says here. This is with a longer delta t, and obviously if the speed picks up, we're going to have shorter delta t's. That's the double whammy. Okay, so here's momentum per bang, here's bangs per second. This is the thing that we pick up. Okay, and I'm going to stick that in to my final velocity. Okay, I'm going to stick that minus vn, minus 2v1, that's my vfin. I'm going to stick that right in here. Okay, and then what do I get? Okay, well, I get the usual m2v2. Okay, I get a minus, so I get 2 of them, and then I get plus m2v1. Okay, so that will be my delta p exactly. Okay, except what I am going to assume now is that V1 really very slow compared to these little atoms that are making our force field. So this is where we get approximate. I'm simply going to get 2 M2 V2, this one, V1 is much less than V2, and then M2 much less than M1. So that's a quadratic out of here. Okay? So this is our guy for momentum transfer. Okay? Approximately 2 times the momentum of the little guy. The little guy is gonna make the force field for us. Okay? Now, taking 1 over delta t approximately v2 over 2y. That's the thing that's multiplying here. What we're getting is a force that's proportional to the kinetic energy of that individual little guy divided by whatever your coordinate is. How far are you away? How much space do you allow in the thing to go to make it a long time between bangs? Okay? So, this is a simplification of what you've seen if you've taken a statistical mechanics course on this subject. Okay, so we're talking about this, and we're just going to say, hey, that's our isothermal force law that we'll always use, and we'll just let the thermodynamics determine what the kinetic energy is of the stuff that's making our force field, and we'll keep the temperature constant, we promise. Stack of Bibles, cross my heart and hope to die. I will not change that velocity. Now that's hard to do if you've got a wall here that doesn't take any kinetic energy, but we don't have walls like that. Walls are very good at getting hot if the gas is hot and taking some velocity away. But that's a situation that we have to get used to. We have to say, okay, whatever the temperature in the environment is, that's what this thing is going to have for kinetic energy. And this is the kinetic energy we're talking about. Okay, but so the idea is that...
But after each collision, V2 will change, right?
Pardon? After each collision, it could change, but you see, what we're having is a big wall sitting there, kind of like in the textbook I describe it as the Federal Reserve Bank, right? Economy starts to heat up. The Federal Reserve is, if it were working perfectly, you see, it would take money out of the economy to make up for that, you see, try to keep that temperature the same. And then when it started to get cold, you know, people are shivering because they don't have houses. All right, the Federal Reserve comes in, heats things back up again. You see, if it were to work that perfectly, we wouldn't have what we do have, which is, you know, exponential swings of the markets and everything. But here, you're sitting in a room like this at 70 degrees. I have things that go close and I have them far. If I do it slowly, you see, they'll pretty much stay at the same temperature. They'll remain isothermal.
You said that for each collision, V2 changed by 2V1, right?
What we're interested, what we were originally interested in is the transfer to M1. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we're interested in the force on M1. Mm-hmm. Okay? Mm-hmm. And the idea is that's a single whammy here. The only thing that's making the force larger as we close in is that there's a shorter time between hits, between momentum transfer. So I'm getting more momentum transferring here than I am here, simply because here it takes me half an hour, you know, to get back and forth, right? Here it's a millisecond, okay? That would be a pretty extreme case, a million times the force that I had there. But, you get the picture. Because somebody, the Federal Reserve, you see, is always checking what the velocity of this is, and if it's too high, it's taking away from it. If it's too low, it's putting it back. And that putting back is rather mysterious. Because you see, this is going to be conservative force too, just like adiabatic. That's the punchline of this whole thing I'm letting out here. But I want to make sure that you see, this is a single whammy. The only thing that reason the force is going up is because there's less time. Speed hasn't changed. V2 hasn't changed. For isothermal, that's the assumption. Now we'll come back to this several times, but I wanted to do the hard one, and that's adiabatic. Because then the velocity does change. But how do you handle that? Okay? If the ceiling is perfectly elastic, and then V2 isn't constant if M1 changes bounce range. Okay?
Yeah.
Basically what we're saying is dy dt v1, let's see if I'm right about that, minus dy dt. What I'm saying is when M1 collides with M2, this is M1 here and M2 coming, it adds twice its velocity to V2. And this occurs at this bang rate.
Yes.
V2 over the distance, velocity over the distance, total distance, 2y. Okay? So you end up with an equation that's just like this. Okay? And I'm using the Bang rate here, V2 over 2y. Okay? And I'm also saying here, let's see if that's right, dv2 to the rate of change of velocity 2 is this 2v1. And we can replace the v1 here. This is the velocity of 1. That's in our coordinate system. This is the y-coordinate of m1. Okay. I've got the coordinate in the wrong direction, so I'm putting a minus sign on if I'm going to be using y. Y1 and is a negative of the y that we've been using up to this point for our ordinate coordinate in the bounce problems here. So this is the equation of motion that will describe how V2 thing. Now I'm going to simplify that. Simply by taking those guys out of there. That's perfectly legitimate. And that, of course, is an easily solvable equation. It involves a logarithmic solution. This thing integrates to a log of V2 equal minus the log of Y plus some constant. I'll go ahead and put the constant in a product like that. And then I can say that the V2 is constant over Y. Okay? So now, what we're going to do is we can simply take this velocity and stick it in the isothermal formula. That's going to give us an extra Y squared in the denominator. So we're going to get a force law that's rather weird, not something you usually play with that much. It doesn't have really simple dynamic solutions, so you don't see it that much. But that's what we're going to play with right there. Constant over y cubed. The constant being the initial v2, that's the constant, and then whatever y was at time equals zero. You have an initial conditions for this. Now I'm going to give a problem, and that's going to be a key to solving it, is to find that constant in some weird bounce situation. But here are the contrasting force laws. Force field, if you will. It's a force that is in a coordinate field, the y field, where the big M1 is sitting here, and there's a force field due to this pesky one atom field. And there's a message there, too. And you see, this is a double whammy. This thing is getting faster, and it's getting more often. But the idea that a potential is almost always traceable to some form of kinetic energy. And finally, in quantum mechanics, to frequency, which is what energy is in the Planck law. So all of this makes a lot more sense quantum mechanically than it does classically. But anyway, we're going to have some other quantum analogs to do with this one as well as we go through here. Okay, so far it makes sense. This is a much harder force law, you see. 1 over y, nice gentle hyperbole, right? 1 over y cubed, you know, it waits for a long time and boom, pops up. Okay? So what are some of the consequences of that? I'm going to take this idea here, you see, of a big mass feeling a potential field, or gradient, due to a small, this is the little guy, much smaller than the big guy, rapidly, V2 also much greater than that of the big guy, and adiabatic case where V2 is a constant over Y, the total energy is strictly conserved. I mean, this is a collision problem here, right? And we've made it. All of the ones we've been doing for the last thing have no friction. There's nothing taking anything away in the adiabatic case. That's the thermal question. That's the weird one. There's a Federal Reserve Bank, but it gets back, as you see, and it'll make this conservation law as well. But right now, this is the thing that we have, a potential energy function of a coordinate. And it's just equal to the kinetic energy of this little guy, the little bouncer. All right? So good? Okay. And the idea is that this is going to relay through work relations, another definition, you see. Force times distance, we're going to call that this usual name for work energy. Okay? Now, again, is this another axiom? No, not. You can prove this one. Okay? If I do an integral of f dy, f being dp dt, that was the last definition that we put in here, okay? And that becomes, and you can just trade dt with denominator here, put the dp isolated, dy dt, that's velocity, v dp, and then p is the momentum of this big guy, mv, okay? So there's your mv squared over 2 that we worked so hard. There's the idea that came from our ellipse that showed up in our momentum conservation. That's one way to do it. The other way is differentially, the force times dy dt, okay? That's can be a changed as well. This is dp dt right here, but I can turn it into that and that, same thing. This is a derivative of a potential, all right? So this is, you know, little calculus trick that gives the answer no here. We have a relationship here that we trust. So we don't need a new axiom for it. But in any case, I need to be careful about how I do the bookkeeping. Now that I have this stuff called potential energy, there's energy that goes into some mysterious bouncing thing, okay? I'm satisfied that it's kinetic energy that is there that I can withdraw from that bank, okay? And the idea is that I can withdraw all of it, perhaps. I'm not going to get swindled by that bank. So what I'm looking for are conservation laws, you see. And that's what I've got already here, but now I've got it with respect to this stuff, this red stuff here, the potential. But how does a physicist view the potential and the force versus a mathematician? When a physicist says he's got a force on something and draws a potential curve, it's almost as though he's saying, well, if this is the potential energy, let me imagine that the potential energy is what we learned first day in most of our physics courses, the potential of the gravity. That the force is equal to the height times gravity, okay? It's proportional to the height. So we kind of imagine this is a slope in which you can slide on, right? So obviously, if the ball is sitting here with a slope like this, and that's what we've got with our 1 over y, that's the force. That's the physicist force right there. And it's equal to minus the slope of that curve. That's something the mathematician says, what do you need that ugly minus sign for? The mathematician's definition has a plus sign in it. And this goes back to the most erudite discussions of electrostatic potentials, which were done by mathematicians. And the one we'll use in chapter 10 of unit 1, when we talk about complex potentials. I don't want pluses and minuses and minus and plus and plus and minus. I want it to always be plus. Just a little less stuff to get tangled up with. Sign errors. 50% less sign errors. Okay? But what is he saying? He's saying that the force is what is taken to hold it there. Okay? And when you say mathematicians are anally retentive, there's proof. This is it. Let it go, right? This is hold it back. Momentum is opposite directions, right? They're looking at the force here on and from. Okay, so that's really Newton's third law at work with the two cultures of mathematician and physicist. All right, okay? But the question is, does this thing work? Is a derivative right? Okay? Because what you're going to see here with a y cubed force, okay, and you take a derivative of that, you get this thing, okay? And that's exactly what we want. That is all the signs and the factors are perfect. This indeed does work. That is a force, and the potential that we're talking about here, 1 over y squared, is just exactly what we need in that proportion. So, good. The 1/2, very important. It just as it was in the derivation of the energy consequence of momentum. Okay? But wait a minute, how are we going to handle isothermal? Okay, this is the way the isothermal is set up, right? We're going to have a force for it, that's the derivative, okay? There's the force, now what's the potential? Got to do the integral, with that lousy minus sign. This is, we're going to be physicists now, okay? You can see, you know, I should be a mathematician, I would have 3 less minus signs up here. So, integrate 1 over y, get logarithm. Oh, wow, logarithms are weird, okay? I get minus a logarithm. So, in place of the nice 1 over y that we had before, I have a log curve, right? Log curve comes up, right? I turn it over, basically. Okay, so this is an upside down log curve here when I'm plotting the potential for this. But yet, I've got a situation here where this will be constant. And you say, how can that be? Because I've got the Federal Reserve taking my energy away, right? Yeah, it's taking it away, so it keeps the velocity constant. But when it comes time, it will give it back. So that's what you're actually seeing with this logarithm here. Your accounting is perfect. You will have conservation of total energy with any potential of y that is a reasonable differentiable integral function, including one that involves the Federal Reserve. Yeah. But it's a perfect Federal Reserve, not the one we've got. Okay, so what I'd like to show you that's kind of neat is what happens if you have two of these opposing isothermal potentials. We'll start with that, and then you'll do a problem where you do this with the adiabatic. Okay, so let's take our isothermal potential, it's the logarithm, okay, a minus logarithm, all right? So the one that is due to the ball on this side of the big guy is going to be that one, and then I'll just put another one on the other side. And somewhere in between here will be a minimum of the sum. So I'm going to be adding f over 1 plus x and f over 1 minus x, where x is going to be this, and I'll just take a unit distance for that. Okay? So I'm going to have f of a series here, and I'm going to have f of a series there. And when I subtract those two, the first term, the one that's linear, is going to be that of a harmonic oscillator. Hooke's law. Force. The force minus kx. The k is going to be equal to twice whatever that f is here, which of course will be those constants there. Okay? So this is going to make for me, at least at the bottom of this curve here, is going to be a parabola, which is the kinetic energy potential. And that's called a harmonic thing because I can start with an amplitude that's really small and do 2 times that or 3 times that. I pretty much get the same frequency. This is something we'll study in detail much later. But the up here, you're going to start getting effects of these higher order terms when x gets bigger than, say, a micron or so. They will build up for you something that's quite different and not a single frequency, but this thing should have a single frequency that's independent of amplitude, at least for small amplitudes. And that's what I'd like to have you see. Now, this is a picture from the original application that was for a Macintosh only, but TC has put up a much better one, and I'm going to start that over here. So let's go ahead on this. I will escape from this and take us forward in the lecture here. Let me get it going here and catch up. So I'm going to speed through the stuff that we just did involving adiabatic and isothermal and mathematicians and stop right here. And I'm going to hope that this works. Let's see what happens. There we go. So we've got furiously bouncing balls on top and bottom. And it makes a very nearly perfect sine curve, or cosine curve, depending where you put the orange. Isn't that wild? The world's simplest harmonic oscillator. There's nothing going on there except the collision mechanics. Nothing at all. Now, slow this down. This is something you can play with. This goes chaotic very, very easily. But the way we've got it right now, it is very, very nicely making harmonic result. We can reset it and have it go again here.
There are presets with other mass ratios. If you follow that first tab, that first button, and go about 3/4 of the way down, you'll see them.
And then the picture here shows a little bit of the, you can just go through the scenarios, but then you can start playing with it. So there's a lot of fun to be had with this, and we haven't explored all of the things we can do with this by any means. So I will pause that and go ahead here. Here's another one taken out with a higher frequency. I think this is a 1 to 500. Well, I'm going to skip that for now since we're going to go a little bit faster than usual. There are a couple of things I wanted to say about that. Where it fails is the interesting parts. Okay. Now, what I'd like to do is in construction, real quick, we have a time here to do that. What I'd like to do is take it to the absolute limit. Basically, infinite ball compared to atom. In other words, an actual kilogram ball, and then some sort of a track that has an atom. Okay? And so the velocity of the ball, we are not going to change it. It is going to stay the same. But the ball is going to pick up speed. And I want to see you to see the construction of that. And the only rule we're going to use, the only rule that we're going to use is that each time the velocity goes up by 2, starts out 0, goes to 2, comes back with minus 2. This will be a perfect wall here. And then it'll pick up another 2 from what it had before to get 4. And come back with minus 4. And then go with 6. That's 4 plus 2, you see. So we're going to just have an arithmetic series of velocities. But we're going to construct them very precisely. So we need the good graph paper. And I've got it in the board here. And I will show you the first few steps through that. And where was the good graph paper? Make sure you have this. And give yourself lots of room on it. I would recommend using at least 6 inches to do the bouncing. And the initial velocity will be, as is shown there on the screen, vehicle 0 will have times here, and this is counting down here. So this would be 1 second before crunch. And you see where the crunch is right at the very bottom, where the ball hits the wall and crushes the atom that's bouncing between the location of the ball, which is on this. This is the track. Time track of M1. This is the time track here. Of the essentially infinitesimal mass M2 coming down with time decreasing. This is 2 seconds before crunch. This is 3 seconds before crunch. Right here is 4 seconds. So at least 4 inches of graph paper vertically. And then you'll have 4 on either side then, which is 8. That's a whole width if you're doing the graph vertically, which is a perfectly reasonable thing to do. But we do need the room to make a lot of lines in this lower portion that have a wonderful geometrical structure that we're going to use a lot of. The one that gives you harmonic series, basically. So the first step, and I'm going to need a medium-sized ruler to do that. I see a large ruler, but I seem to have misplaced. Here we go. This one will do fine for me. I'll grab it over here. What I'm going to need is something that has a slope of, here we're going from, when we're looking at slope, that's slope 0, if you're looking at the thing. With your head tipped at 90 degrees. And what I want to do is give it a slope of 2 units in distance per 1 unit of time. And that means that, I'm assuming, you see, that you've already drawn a 45 degree line.
So
right,
that's 45-degree angle?
Unitary velocity. Velocity is 1. It's a big one. It's covered on the screen. That's your starting point.
Assume that you've got the requisite 45-degree line in there. This minus 45, I guess, is a better name for it. But that's the track of the big M1. And it's going to hit that ball is coming down there and add to its velocity, which is 0, 2 units. Okay? 2 of its units. Its velocity is 1. Okay? This is a track of M1, V1 equal 1. And here comes V0. It's going to be adding 2 times V1, which is just 2, to its velocity. Okay? Well, that means it's going to have a velocity of 2. It's going to go 2 spatial units in 1 time unit. Okay? So draw a line through the point that you can use to mark on your graph paper, so it makes the graph paper easily. Is this thing is going to have a slope, looking at this graph horizontal with your head tipped, of 2. And that line I want to go and what I want it to go through, not just this line right here, I want it to go all the way down there. And at first this looks like a setup job, but no matter what these conditions are, you're going to get this kind of weird symmetry. So that would be where it hits the wall. Okay? So this is the time track of the stationary wall. Well, track in time. Okay, so that's where it's going to hit, and it should be right here, halfway between 1 and 2, where it hits. But it should continue, and we'd be going 3 units out this way. That line should, if everything is kosher here, end up. That should be parallel to intersection with position minus plus 3 on this axis. So it should come down through here.
So initially this big mass comes through the ramp?
Yes, initial.
It's just moving in one direction.
It's moving.
And it's popping in.
It's moving, you know, across the board all the way. But obviously it's going to stop here. The wall, we'll assume, is infinite, really infinite. The ball is just a little infinity, okay? So the ball is going, the front end of the ball, okay, is following that trajectory right there, and all is going to come to naught at this point. That's the crunch, okay? So this is the monster mash ends right there.
So the 2V1 is the velocity of the small.
Yes, this is V equal 1 for that. This right here is V2. It's just been made into plus 2. And this is V2 equals 0. And the collision resulted in that change right there, which is, you know, pretty much what we have. And TC's putting it on the screen, but we'll look at that later on. Let's just get the geometry straight here. But what I'm going to do, of course, is assume that the wall reflects the little ball back to the thing. So it's going to come up to the wall with V2 equal
plus 2.
And it's going to reflect without any loss to minus 2. Okay, so that puts you back at the intersection right there.
We can just use law of reflection, right, to draw?
And that of course is what that 2 times V1 is, right? So here is V2 with minus 2. Okay, and then the next thing it's going to do is pick up another 2. It's got a speed of 2 now, it's going to pick up another 2 times V1.
But provided if it hits with that ball, right?
It's going to hit it right here. The little guy is going to hit the big ball right there, okay? And it's got this speed, so this is going to pick up twice that as an extra speed. So we're going to be talking 4 units, okay? And that's exactly what we've got here. Let's go ahead and put some numbers here. This right here is minus 1. This right here is minus 2. And this is minus 3. You can make sure to check that out with it. And this will be plus 1, plus 2, and plus 3. Okay? Now it's really easy to get 4, which is what we need, simply by using the graph paper. Okay? In 1 unit of time, I need to go 4 units of distance, which is exactly what I need to go through that point again. So if the wall were suddenly to develop a hole or disappear, that point down at the end there is where all of these balls would end up. But ours bounces right here. So our ball comes in, we draw it heavily right here, a heavy line. That's a ghost ball that continues through the wall. There's the real ball coming back. Here's the ball bouncing again with that extra two now on top of the original two to give us a velocity of four, plus four, which will turn into a velocity of minus four very shortly. So V2 has now become minus four, and it's going to reflect to plus four. And plus four will go right through that point there, if I'm not mistaken. Let me check to see if that, I believe that is right. Let's see where this one goes. This, what I'm looking at is, I'm a little bit worried that the geometry here isn't quite right, but this one should, as it's, let's flip back to the graph here. This one right here that goes two will intersect over at this point. And then the next time it reflects, it also intersects at that point. And it doesn't show it quite with as nice a graph as this, but this is out there 3 units. So this should be out there at 3 units as well. That kind of looks right. So I'm a little worried that this doesn't
quite. It's just a little off in the corner intersection.
Yeah, it's a little bit off in the corner on this graph. I don't know what happened.
You could fudge it, I bet.
Yeah, I hit it a little high right there. That's the problem with this. I should have hit it in the center right there. And so always make a fat line when you make a mistake if the mistake isn't too big. So that should end up there. And then when this one reflects, same thing. This is the actual plus four velocity, but this continues and also meets down there. So this is a very quick way to bounce the ball back and forth. Now we don't have to very carefully measure its slope. We'll let the geometry produce our next one, which has a velocity of minus six. I'm sorry, plus six. This one will have V plus six. This was minus four coming back. So this will be a V2 equal plus six right there.
Plus eight, right?
Plus two.
You add 2 units each time. You don't double.
2 times V1, right?
Yep. You're always adding 2 times V1. Remember when you climbed up the ellipse side? Always 2V1, right? So this is the logical limit, you might say, with that. And that's going to come back with a minus 6, which is, again, a line that goes through the end of our graph, where the V1 point's coming in. So here is that. Right through there. And then the next one will be 8 after that, going from that point right there. The slope is getting more and more like units of 2 every time. And it comes back with minus 8 to hit the ball even closer. But then, and I swiveled the graph, I got a curvy ruler here that won't have any friction down at the end, so I have to be very careful drawing that line. And so forth. Now, in next one is there, goes to there, and I'll let you finish. It's obviously easier to do this on paper with a good graph behind it, but that is really a beautiful sort of geometry that we're seeing there. And the main rule here, the main rule which I've got written on the screen, is first of all, V2 is, for the most part, given by a constant divided by the distance. Okay, but another way to write that is that y, the distance allowed, times the velocity, is constant. And the extrapolation, it's sort of crazy, sounds crazy at first to say this, but the velocity that you have at any moment, you might want to, if you had a unit mass m2, you might ascribe that to a delta p, remember it can be plus or minus, and then this is the space allowed, the delta, let's call it y, and then this is py, is a constant. And what I would like to say, and we're going to try to justify this much later, this is Heisenberg uncertainty. This is with an enormous N. We're talking about really high quanta here. We could do a quantum where we only gave it the first excited state for this thing and then move in on. That's a very interesting quantum experiment. Very hard one. You see, this is the thing you learn about the relationship between classical and quantum mechanics. Is classical mechanics will never be obsolete since doing things like this is really easy, but doing the quantum mechanical equivalent is really demanding and hard. And interesting. I didn't say it. Sometimes hard things are very interesting. So I leave that with you here. TC had put up the picture. I'm going to try to do it again if I can. That shows that happening. Let me go back to the monster mesh, and I will pull this up. This is the one that shows approximately. Now the trouble is that it crushes it literally, and so it doesn't come back with quite the kinetic energy it went in with.
It's pretty bossy.
But okay, crunch, or bang rather. Then the wall is coming up here. Bounce perfectly. Crunch. The little rectangles maintain their area. And if you keep the kinetic energy...
So that's the meaning of y times v2 is constant, right?
Yeah.
The area?
Yeah. Yep. What you're talking about is conservation of action. That's very subtle. Very subtle point.
It is not crunch, right? It is kaboom, right?
Say that again.
You are telling it is crunch. It is not, it is kaboom, right? It's actually elastic, right?
Everything should be elastic. This wasn't quite. Because it exceeded the speed of the integrator. That's what went wrong. Kinetic energy it's not flowing. Right?
This scenario actually retained the energy, it just has a different sort of configuration after the collision.
Yeah, you have a bunch of three-body things that are a little squirrely that redistribute the energy.
Mm-hmm.
But in a perfect situation like this, I could follow this all the way to the point there, and that area rule is being held. So I'm going to give you a couple of problems to play with this system. I mean, can't get much simpler system, but you can't get a much deadlier one either. I mean, it's really amazing what we're asking this thing to do. And as I say, the future allows. Now, the structure of this geometry, I want to show you, ultimately, this is a wave relationship. This is just an identity in Fourier analysis. So let's switch, and just for the fun of it, for the rest of the lecture here, I'm going to show a wave behavior that has the same geometry. So let me go ahead in this copy of the lecture right here to the next page where we show the double monster mesh. Here I'm coming in with an arbitrary velocity, and I'm not putting a wall there, I'm just putting two balls colliding with each other. And the interesting thing is the translation time and space invariance of such a thing. You can read in unit one, around figure 6.6, what's the geometry of all of the structures in there. They really are, I mean, you recognize that geometry, that's the plus two, plus two, plus two geometry. And, two velocity things, but what is the other stuff? Well, this is some interesting fractional geometry. It's what I call projective geometry that it is worth learning about. I'm not going to stall too much, except to say that if I draw the wall in a Galilean transform thing, I get the same structure. It's just that this inside there is equal to the thing in there. So there's this Galilean, it's invariant to Galilean shifts, as obviously it should be, but it's really invariant. The coordinates that are made by those lines are invariant. Now what I'd like to show you is a four wave that has been crunched. What does it do? That's what we're going to study right here. And this is really quite beautiful. As you can see, in space and time, it's the same sort of geometry that we're talking about here. Lines with a slope of 1, then 1 half, then 1 third, then 1 fourth, then 1 fifth. You see a harmonic series of slopes that you would get simply because you're fitting a wave onto a ring with integral number of wavelengths. And this is a wraparound, as it says there, of a full 2 pi circle, and a Bohr wave has been made on there out of enough combinations to make a very skinny Gaussian that explodes. I call it the tiny Big Bang. It's a universe of one dimension and a wave of the simplest possible variety, just kinetic energy for its energy Hamiltonian. So what we're going to do is look at the evolution of that wave. And all you have to do, if I'm right, is click on that and it will start. But let me tell you what you'll be seeing. You'll be seeing the Gaussian at the bottom, at first very narrow. I think the one that we have is narrower than that. And then here's a picture of the whole circle. Here's the thing in the center. And you'll see it marching around the globe, so to speak. It's sort of an explosion that is going to ring out over the entire globe and then reform, unbang. So this class is about bangs, but in quantum mechanics we have unbangs too. So let me go ahead and just click on that. I'm going to also go ahead on this one to that point so that we can refer back to it and to other things that are going to happen. So here it goes. This is, if everything is right, the animation in wave it. Yes, bang. So it bangs and then it starts to interfere with itself at the south pole. And when that interference occurs, you make little ripples in the space-time continuum. And there are the lines that we have been drawing, crossing each other. And that's where you see in the zeros of the real part of the wave, white regions, look like little flying saucers. At the fractions, 1/10, 1/9, 1/8, 1/7, 1/6, we're about to have 1/5. Bang! And we have a star up here, you see, so you know it's 1/5. And then we've got a long way to go before we get to 1/4, but in the meantime, we pick up there. That's 1/4. It happens to be north and south pole. Very big flying saucers, a pair of them. But you can see it's all going to a crunch. This thing is going to make a great big zero out in the middle of the screen, and the Gaussian will reform at the south pole, which is the edges of this diagram. So this is how a wave would draw those lines, and we need to explore that, because it's just based on fractions, but fractions are the source of fractals. So once you learn your fractions really well, and I recommend the thing we're about to show, if you have kids and you're teaching them and they're hating their fractions, you can make them love fractions by what we're going to be looking at shortly. At least some of them. There's a chance that you can make them interested in mathematics just with this type of geometry.
So what are these places, these white lines you see?
White, as you can see from, is where the thing is nearly zero. So it's where the wave is not. And that's a real message for quantum mechanics. Garage mechanics, you got to worry about where things are, right?
So
quantum mechanics, you worry about where things are not. That is the real question.
So what you're doing is you're actually sending a Gaussian wave packet around a cylinder?
Well, actually, I'm not sending anything. I'm just saying the frequency should be energy equal p squared over 2m, m is 1, so energy should be equal to p squared over 2. And then p is h bar k. So that's the thing that determines the wavelength, you see. And for each wavelength, and I'm only allowed integral amounts of the circumference, right? I'm allowed one that's just constant everywhere, that's a zero. But then I'm allowed one that has a cosine wave, 1, in the circumference, and then I'm allowed 2, and 3, and 4, and 5. And I've got this thing probably cranked up, so I'm using about maybe 25 of the eigenstates to make that first state, the Gaussian, that you saw at the beginning of the movie. And then you just let it ring. Each one of them has a frequency that's a square of that wave number. That's all, that's the only rule in here. Is our 1/2 mv squared rule, or p squared over 2m. That's the only rule, and it gives you this. Can you imagine how happy Bohr would have been to see this? This is the original Bohr model of an atom, just a ring, okay? No radial dependence, just angular. This is the angular part. Which the full Schrodinger hydrogen will do too. I mean, there are all kinds of things that do this. Okay, so let's jump a little bit more. We've got about 10 minutes to keep within an hour and 20 here. As I point out, whenever you have a fraction with a denominator 7, let's say, you're going to see 7 waves. If you have a denominator 6, you're going to see half of 6. It always tries to take the factors out. This is something that's factoring, giving you all the fractions that exist on the real line with a denominator of less than whatever I assigned to be the highest Gaussian wave number. And as I said, I have about 30 on there, so 15 is about as as fine as it's going to get. You crank that up and you'd be seeing stuff in here. But right now it's smooth. You don't have enough energy to see this region. But it would have all these crisscrosses also. All the way down to here, if you could put in, a energy of a million. Okay? So that's what's happening periodically. That's what you see on the ring. But when you look at it in space and time, wow, you really see some structure. Just exactly what we have there. Okay? So, this is just showing you some of the things that you can set. There's the actual Fourier distribution that made that. Okay, now these are the actual lines. Lines of slope 1, and they're very obvious. It's a little harder to see where things are, but there is a line that you can barely see sort of going through right here. That's where the particle is. Where a particle is it's worthless. Waves are based on where they're not. It's very zen, this stuff called quantum mechanics. Okay, so there's a slope 1/2, then there's 1/3, you see, then there's 1/4, you see, and then there's 1/5, there's 1/6, and each one of them echoing back and forth. Okay, that's all this is. So that's what we have to analyze. We have to analyze the fractions as geometrical objects. It took us a while to figure this out. And part of it, in various separate ways, had been figured out. But anyway, here's time, units of tau. Okay, here's the coordinate, phi, that we're talking about. Phi being extended across and or around 2 pi, 0 to 2 pi, or minus pi to plus pi. Okay, this is in units of 2 pi, right? And I've just picked an arbitrary denominator, say 1d. But it reflects and comes 1d again, but this is a 2 over d, right? Then there's 3 over the denominator that I've picked, whatever it is, number 2. Okay? That'd probably be about 8 or so. D is probably about 8 for that one. Now, where they cross is where you get some activity, either a pulse or a really big zero. And the pulses are small, the zeros are big, so the zeros are things that win. Okay? Here I have a 1 over d, okay? This one coming from the other side, okay? It's going to mate with this one, okay? And of course, it's been building up too. Okay? What I'm imagining is that I've got the number n1 of the 1 over d trajectories intersecting n2 number of the 1 over d2 trajectories. I want to find out where that is. What's that intersection right there in angle and time, space-time? This is relativity, beginning of some very funny relativity, okay? So, what we have, all of the N2, D2 paths have a slope 1 over D2. All of the N1, D1 paths have a slope minus 1 over D2. So it's just write an equation for each of those ones. The N1 over D1 looks like that. And this one, this is just a slope relationship involving delta T over delta phi, okay? And we're looking at 1/2 minus phi as a distance there, okay? So we solve that equation, and we get this for the time, and this for the angle. Now this is called a fairy sum, after a geologist who didn't get it this way, as far as I can tell from the literature, but this is as good a way as I can think of to get a sum of fractions. And what he's showing is, what he was finding with tides, is if you have, for example, a period 3 tie, 1/3, and say a period 5 tie, the Fairy sum would be 2 over 1 plus 1 over 3 plus 5. That's 2 over 8, which is 1/4. You see, you should expect to see a quarter. That was his rule of thumb for finding harmonics and subharmonics in ties. So that's what the Fairy sum does. It helped Fairy in 1816. This is really old. Okay? Now, more recent, 1938, is Lester Ford doing a completely different sort of thing involving some circles, which we'll get to in just a second here. We've got about 5 minutes to do that. So let's take it slowly. So far, this makes sense. We now have a formula for the time and space of intersections of particular repetitions, that's the number, of particular fraction, that's the denominator. Okay, so it's numerators and denominators that we're playing with here. So it occurred to me, we ought to plot numerators versus denominators. If you want to find all the fractions, that is, all the things that are interesting in solid-state physics, for example, are places where things meet like this, why don't we just put a numerator axis and a denominator axis like this. Each of the possible fractions, you see, will be something here over something here. And it'll be represented by a point out in numerator and denominator space. Okay, that's all it is. All right. Now, a Fairy sum of the fractions 0, 1, and 1, 1 is 1/2. I'm showing that because that's a vector sum. Here is the 1, 1 fraction right there, 1 over 1. So it's a pretty simple fraction. 1 over 1 equals 1. Okay. And in fact, that points at 1.0 on the real line. And the Fairy sum of that with, say, this one, this is a fraction 0 over 1. 0 over that, that's 0, okay? It points at 0 on the real line, okay? The Fairy sum of those two is a little parallelogram, kind of like the ones we did for our momentum stuff here, except that links are a little different, but if I do a Fairy sum, that is a vector sum of these two vectors, I get 1 over 2. Okay, 1 over 2 points at 0.5. So this is a really neat way to associate all of the fractions that can possibly live and be have an address on the real line. And that's what these waves are finding out for us automatically. They are finding the rationals of the reals. Okay? So one of the things that you do is you draw a circle for the very each of these fractions. This one is just a great big circle that intersects there. Okay? The idea is this vector V2, the one that we got by doing the vector sum, okay, that's the Fairy sum of these fractions, and it points to a real value, okay, 1/2, 0/2, in fact the intersections of the circle are right at that particular point, but this one is the pointer, okay, that I pointed out the pointer already, okay, let's go next step here. What you do, once you get there, is find the intersection of this big circle with that line and draw a radius right to there. Okay, now that's an interesting point. And this is where the geometry really gets weird. Because at that point, okay, is the center of a Ford circle 4/1/2, a circle that is identified with this particular real value of 0.5, 1/2. There it is. You draw that and you set your compass and it's tangent. Wow, that's cool. That is really cool. Now, how am I going to make you remember this? How many of you have seen the movie Titanic? 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 Al, of course. Titanic? Do you remember the main female character had a jewel? Mm-hmm. And when she had her portrait done, she wore it that way. This way you will never forget Ford Circle number 2. Now, if this girl had more jewels, smaller ones, she could easily afford them, she's very rich, right? You could finish this. That's one half. There's one third and two thirds. There's a one third. Two third would be sitting equally on the other side. She's balanced. Okay, I'm just going to draw this side now. Okay? There's a whole bunch of other jewels you get from doing the fairy sum over and over again and identifying in a hierarchical way this is doing of all of the real that have their principal fractions. And this goes on and just fills densely the real line, you see. Make denominator 1/16, I can start filling in here. Make 1/32, I can start filling up to here, you see. At some point you need incredible resolution to see it. Because the n over d circles have a diameter of 1 over d squared. So that diameter drops quickly. Anyway, I thought you'd enjoy seeing this. This is up to 11. Just done by mostly sort of by hand on a drawing program, but we have done this on hand. Now, our recent paper that we just came out in July with Lee, Ellison Lee, if you remember him, because he was here just a little while ago, and Mike and Reed P. We've identified little rectangles that are in there, and that's useful for studying fractal structure of a very famous potential for molecular physics, which I won't go into right here. But the structure of this is really quite neat. These are Thales rectangles. This goes back to 600 BC. These are all Thales rectangles that have the fractional ratios that are assigned to their Ford circles. So this is totally new. This is not something that was in discussions that I've seen in the references that I've given to you so far. Anyway, when you get this thing at home on a screen, I would recommend that you do the magic 3D eye if you have the ability to do that. This 3D eye takes you to infinity. All of the other ones have a finite backdrop. This one doesn't. And you just have to experiment with that. But it looks a lot better on a monitor of high resolution. Okay, now what I want to stop with this point. When we filled the ellipse with our trajectories for 1/7 or any other fraction for that matter that didn't have a lot of symmetry and therefore was one of the lower fractional values, in principle, there is a possibility that you completely fill. That's called ergodicity. But I am conjecturing that, in fact, you never really can fill it. In other words, nature isn't going to let you do it. I have a question mark about ergodicity. You can make it look pretty good. You can make it look solid. But you take a microscope to it, you're going to see stuff like that and that. One other thing, we were talking about construction of ellipses. This is a construction, but the point is the estrangeant makes this construction totally obsolete. We don't need it. So that's, you know, I considered that progress. Because this, I never could get anything simpler than that. Maybe you can, but you just switch the ball game to circles, and you don't have this problem anymore. You don't have to find the ellipse. Okay, that's an example of what I would call progress, and it's done geometrically. I mean, it's a geometrical piece of work. Circle wins. Okay, Any questions or comments? We'll get that after you do the problems, and which will come next week. You have an easy set this week, so enjoy it.